Hi, everybody. This is Crystal Proxmire of Oakland County Times. We're here today with Congressperson Alyssa Slotkin, who currently represents the 8th district, but is running for, because of redistricting, it will be the 7th district that she's running for. How are you today?
I'm good. How are you, Crystal?
Good. Thank you for doing this interview. Can you just give us a rough idea of what communities are in the new 7th district?
Sure. The new 7th district, put together by our independent commission, is a district with Lansing at the heart of it and sort of all the rural counties around it. It's Ingham County, where Lansing and East Lansing are. It's Eaton County, Clinton County, Shiawassee County, Livingston County. It's two places in Oakland County, Milford Township and South Lyon, and then 200 people in Genesee County in Argentine. So it's a much bigger, physically bigger district than the one I currently represent, which is Ingham, Livingston, and North Oakland.
So in your time in Congress thus far, what are some of the things that you're most proud of?
Well, I've been in since I was sworn in January of 2019. And so about 3.5 years. And I think it's two things that I'm most proud of. One is the approach that I've tried to take in the work, which comes from me being a national security person by training, CIA officer and former Pentagon official with 3 tours in Iraq. There just really isn't partisanship when you're focused on national security. It just doesn't come up. The best ideas are the ones that get, rise to the top. And I've tried to take that same approach by joining things like the Problem Solvers Caucus, the only bipartisan caucus in the House, and just being independently minded when it comes to my votes. I was voted the 9th most bipartisan member out of 435. So it's something that comes naturally, but I've continued in my time in Congress. So approach. But then, obviously the work of a legislator is to legislate and to help people with constituent services. On legislation, I was really proud, frankly, to pass some prescription drug pricing legislation that was built bipartisan and signed by President Trump that will go into effect in January that allows you to basically have like good RX for Medicare patients the minute you leave, before you leave the doctor's office. You get a printout of where to get your drugs most cheaply on your plan, in district pharmacy or in network pharmacy. And then constituent services, like when we get a call from someone who has a problem with, Social Security, unemployment, the VA benefits, we are a live human being who helps get to the bottom of that problem. We've helped get, certainly this term over $1 million, this term and last term over $1 million back for people. So we feel strongly about delivering at the local level as much as we do on big pieces of legislation.
So you mentioned your background in national security. Can you just tell us a little bit more about your professional experience and the skills you bring to the table? Skills that you bring to the table?
Sure. So I went into national security because I happened to find myself on my second day of grad school in New York City on 9/11. And by the time that day ended, I knew that I was going to go into national security as a career. I got recruited out of grad school by the CIA. And within a year of joining at CIA, I was sent on my first of 3 tours in Iraq. And my job was to understand the terrorist and militia groups that were shooting at U.S. forces and plotting against the U.S. homeland, and traveling around with the military, helping them understand those groups so that we could dismantle those groups. In between those 3 tours, I was coming back to Washington and working for whoever was my commander in chief. I worked for the Bush administration. I actually was asked to work in the Bush White House and brief the president, regularly, sometimes twice a day on Iraq. And I was there the Friday he left office and the Monday that Barack Obama came in, and did the same job for a very different president. And then ended up working at the Pentagon for another 7 years and left as an assistant secretary of defense, an acting assistant secretary of defense. So, I think to me, the most important thing is having experience in mission-driven work, in work where it's just not about egos and about the individuals, it's about the mission of helping people, and that partisanship does not help that mission at all. Like I said, I hope to bring those skills. I feel I bring those skills to the job. But then also, I think it's just looking objectively at a piece of legislation when it comes to my desk. And, you know, it's amazing to me how many members of Congress don't even bother to read the legislation. And I have a pretty solid record of not always voting with my party. And I think, again, that comes from being an independently minded person and from personal experience. And then also just like seeing things through to that final mile. You know, I'm very aware that a lot of people in Michigan have really started to question whether government helps or hurts, right? Whether like the government is a good thing that helps enrich their lives. And when you're on the other end of that phone call and they call you and they're like, I can't get reimbursed by the VA. I have $14,000 that I need that it's tied up. Like, can you help me? Just delivering, and that if you say you're going to do something, that's one thing. Actually getting that $14,000 check to someone changes their life. And that's the purpose of the work, not to talk about doing things, but to actually deliver.
So what are some of those things that you want to work on if you're reelected?
So I think for me, the issues that I'm focused on are the ones that help defend and expand the middle class. Like our country, our state certainly is defined by having a really solid middle class. And that comes from our tradition of building cars, of just sort of inventing that concept that you could be an auto worker working on the line and afford the car that you're building. And so I think that all good things come in this country when we have a solid middle class. And I think that's what's at risk right now. I focus on the things that help keep people in the middle class and help expand the middle class. The price of healthcare and prescription drugs is just way too high, period. It's too much of our percentage of our you know, monthly income. So we must work on that if you wanna solidify the middle class. Number two, just economic and supply chain issues. And I think we all learned that in spades with COVID, there are certain critical items that you must make in the United States. And we have let ourselves become overly dependent on China. You don't have to look further than, you know, plants that I represent, Grand River, GM's plant, Grand River plant, where they were on and off for the past year and a half because they can't get a 14-cent microchip. That doesn't make any sense. And I think supply chain issues are an area where I've spent a lot of time. And we have our first big, like from the ground up plant, electric vehicle battery plant being built in Delta Township in the 7th District. And that's what it's about. It's about good paying jobs with dignity for generations. And then I would say lastly, our state's identity is tied to water. The water we drink, the water we enjoy as part of our heritage, our lakes, our rivers, our streams. We have to make sure that our kids and our grandkids get that natural legacy that they deserve. And that's by watching what happens with our water and with our environment. So those are the things I spend a lot of time on. To be honest, the other one that I look forward to really kind of expanding on if I get reelected is this issue of food security as national security. Our farmers, you know, it could have gotten pretty hairy during COVID if we had not been able to feed ourselves. Can you imagine if it weren't toilet paper that we were stressed about, it was food? You know, you walked into a grocery store, there's no meat, there's no chicken, there's no commodities. I mean, people would have freaked out, right? So to me, we have to be more deliberate about our ag policy, and we need to treat food security like national security. And if I work hard and get reelected, I would like to be on the agriculture committee. There's a ton of ag in the new 7th district. And that's an area where I think my national security world and my Michigan representative world really meet.
So in this race, there is some competition for this seat. Why should the voters pick you?
Well, I mean, certainly there's healthy competition is the Democratic way. And there's just really big differences between myself and my opponent. My opponent has a primary, but assuming that he surmounts that primary, I think you have folks who are just really different about how we see the world. Certainly in terms of sort of a more extreme way. I just don't think the average person in Michigan, in mid-Michigan, is an extreme person who enjoys extreme partisanship. I think that you know, my dad was a Republican, lifelong Republican, my mom a lifelong Democrat, and we never fought bitterly. And I don't think the average Michigander likes how bitter it's become. And that's pretty different from my opponent, who's a pretty solid partisan and who makes everything political and sort of will never sort of say, oh, you know, that's not, that idea didn't come from my party, but it's a good idea. I certainly think on issues of economic development, we're very different. I mean, this bipartisan deal to bring this new electric vehicle battery plant, brand new plant from GM to our district, he voted against. He was one of a very small number of either Democrats or Republicans who voted against this incentive package for GM. It was a bipartisan deal signed by the legislature and the governor. So he's really outside the kind of normal kind of, you know, sort of bipartisan shock group on that. Certainly on issues around identity you know, the issue of choice in Roe v. Wade, he's celebrating the 1931 law that's on the books in Michigan that would ban abortion in all cases. He believes in no exceptions. So for violent rape or incest or just, you know, health concerns of the mother, there's just real differences between us there. But then approach, you know, I mean, look, one of the things I'm bragging about is that I got this bill on prescription drugs signed by President Trump. He was the president when we signed it, and I worked hard. And I will say I was thrilled when he did that. My opponent just doesn't see the world that way. He could never sort of concede that good ideas should come from lots of different places. And I think he's just gotten more and more extreme over the years. And that's just not how I believe the average person wants their country run.
So if the voters want more information about you and your campaign, where can they go?
Sure. We, of course, have a website, alyssaforcongress.com. And we're on Twitter. We're on all the social media sites. You just have to Google us. And I look forward to for people to investigate. Everyone's got their issue that they care the most about. And I want to answer questions and get out there. And I have to earn people's votes. And that's what I hope to do.
Great. Well, thank you for taking the time to talk with us today.
Of course. Thanks so much, Crystal.